There's no tenderness like before.
So when we sang with Phil on the phone, he says, and we said, that's just the dummy title. He said, no, it's not. He said, that's the title, you know.
So then we got together with him and wrote, you know, the rest of it, which was like going off into a completely different direction that we never would have thought of without him.
There's no tenderness like before in your fingertips. You're trying hard not to show it.
Working with a great singer when you've got a song that you care about is the most wonderful thing, because when they enhance what you've done and they take it to places you never thought it could go, it's just great.
And I'm sure that they took a little liberties themselves.
Yeah.
I mean that high note that Bobby did, you know, when he goes way up there, I didn't do that. To me, that was a great combination of a really great song, great artist, great production. But even though that it was great, we never thought that song would end up becoming the most played song of the 20th century. It blows our mind.
But even as Tin Pan Alley hit another peak with You've Lost That Loving Feeling, the role of the professional songwriter was again under threat. This time in the shape of four young musicians from Liverpool who wrote their own material and whose influence was about to change the American music scene forever.
America's domination of pop music was about to end. Enter the British invasion.
The group occupied the top five slots and had seven other singles in Billboard magazine's US Hot 100.
I can't get no.
But America's response to Britain's Atlantic crossing was swift, catchy, and telling.
Nothing compared to Motown.
Walk On By continues 7:30 next Sunday.
In the 1960s, American pop dominated the music charts, but all that was about to change.
didn't sound like nobody else. They really did not sound like no other group that was around at the time. Nobody.
There was a freshness and an electricity. You know, I mean, yeah, they were doing Little Richard, but they weren't doing Little Richard. I mean, yeah, you know, that was Little Richard? No. Yes? No. You know.
Doing our thing, and then we went, uh-huh. Something has happened here. Here came the self-contained group that was writing their own material, and we were scared. I mean, we was going, what are we going to do? We can't write for them. They're writing their own songs.
I'd gotten used to having a certain amount of record royalty every year. I just took that for granted, and all of a sudden it was drying up, you know? And so I did what I thought was a pretty smart thing.
Is it possible to get a picture of you? 2 foot by 4 foot fit on my bedroom wall.
I had a painter do portraits of the Beatles and got the license to market Beatle pictures. And for about a year in that middle 60 period, I made more money selling pictures of the Beatles than I was selling my my own records. Within a couple of years, they took over the record business. And there was no way to stop this incredible British invasion.
Nobody in America would buy anything from any other category or genre of music. It had to be that kind of Beatle beat stuff. I was noticing that they were doing a lot of sort of passing chords that I'd learned in folk music. Like instead of going like from here to here to here, they'd go and then.
Music changed from becoming a keyboard-oriented music business to a guitar-oriented business.
And it's a first-time welcome now for that top four with their top hit, You Really Got Me Going, The Kinks.
Girl, you really got me going. You got me so I don't know what I'm doing. Yeah, you really got me now. You got me so I can't sleep at night.
Kinks were one of the new British guitar groups who also successfully made the Atlantic crossing.
Certainly the first thing that grabs you is the guitar riff. The sentiment of the song, I mean, if you want to call it sentiment, it, You Really Got Me, and the harmonies that went with it, and the way it built, all went together to make what I'd have to call a natural. It was one of those records that I don't think could have been improved on. Also was fortunate that Dave was into loud guitar and had this little amplifier we used to kick every now and then, so it got a nice raucous sound out of it. And all came together and, you know, nicely in, dare I say, harmony.
Like many other British groups in the 60s, the Kinks' style was based on black American rhythm and blues. Ironically, they were so good at recreating it that their record company, Pye, originally wanted them to stick with cover versions of R&B classics.
Pye, quote-unquote, ordered me to do first single that of Long Tall Sally, the old Little Richard song, which I did sort of under protest, but I figured what the hell they were paying for it. And it got okay, but it was hardly the Kinks. And at that point, they and I rebelled and said, we really want to do what Ray's writing because this is what we're here for in the first place. And the reason why he signed this band, or the alleged reason why he signed this band. So the next single was You Really Got Me. And the rest, I guess, as they say, is history.
You really got me. the first British act to follow the Beatles to the number one spot in the American charts with The Animals.
There is a house in New Orleans. They cool the rising sun.
The House of the Rising Sun was one of two covers they made of Nina Simone tracks, and she was not amused.
She looked at me and said, so you're the hunky bastard who took my song and screwed it up, and I said, wait a minute, you know, if you're gonna complain about us taking that song and recording it, why don't you admit to the fact that, you know, you've made fortunes out of singing work songs from prison, work songs from guys who are still doing time on the chain gang down there in Angola State Prison. And she was pretty shocked that I would know that much. And from that point on, it was like, oh, okay, my name's Nina Simone, what's your name? In the early days on the road in the States, we'd wander into black clubs, and people would look at us sideways and say, you know, what's these honky guys doing in here? And then I'd get up on stage and sing with people like Grant Green and Louis Jordan and people like that, and Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee, and they would immediately open their hearts, you know, to you. The music is the answer. Music is the key. And it's religion.
Blues may have been central to the sound of the Animals, but they made sure that America was well aware of their nationality.
We used to actually put Made in England or Made in Britain on the label in America. And it wasn't. It was pressed in America, but Union Jacks on everything.
Although British performers may have had the golden touch, some of the groups still look to America for their songs.
Every other Sunday for 5 years, I was on an aeroplane to America. And next morning, up and working. And it was from 9:30 to 9:30 at night, going from publisher to publisher, from Monday to Friday, really. I saw everybody. Everybody would see me, I saw. And there I found the tunes in the Broom Building and places like that.
In this dirty part of the city, where the sun forgets to shine.
We had written for the Righteous Brothers, so it was a very Righteous Brothers kind of demo. I mean, it was a great demo. And when the Animals cut it, they changed the feel, they changed the chords, they changed the words, they changed everything.
In this dirty old part of the city, where the sun